So I was just scrolling through some of my images that I've done, and I was saying that, like, that process behind it, when I had to create it, gave me so much fun, you know? And today, probably looking at this image, you can generate something very similar in AI, or, you know, just write, like, prompt, like a cool-looking World War I soldier. It does create the image for you, but I don't think there's any joy behind it. Again, it will find its own usage, you know, like you will probably use it in a design process where you have to design something. But in terms of like personal satisfaction and personal sort of process of creating something, I don't think anything could take that away from artists. The question obviously is, how do you align that with obviously making money? Because we do a lot of stuff for fun, but unfortunately not all the time it pays you back in terms of supporting your life, you know. But then again, we will find that golden mean where we'll still be doing stuff that we like, and also that will give us a decent income. But what I realized, like, a lot of times I really appreciate not making stuff from scratch, that's not the point, but actually working on something and creating something, and that experience itself really kind of brings that joy and allows me to kind of enjoy my sort of work, I would say, right? So every obviously I do use the similar process when I work. For example, like if I open any kind of this Mandalorian concept, probably there will be AI at a certain point where you can type in like, oh, generate this scene with sunny weather with Baby Yoda playing with kids, and it will spit out something very similar probably, or something even maybe cooler. But I still, like, I remember creating this image, and I remember the joy and feeling of like being so interested in how this is going to turn out. And that whole process was really, really appealing to me as an artist, you know. And obviously, that's something I don't think is going anywhere. And to support this idea, you can look at the transition between traditional and obviously digital media. You know, when digital media came out, there were a lot of like conversations as well, right? Like a lot of similar conversations that we have today, right? Is it the real art? You know, I do believe there's still people out there who don't believe that digital art is a real art because it's not tactile, you know, it's not something you can touch. But it is art, you know, it's just another form of art. And did that mean that a lot of traditional artists lost their jobs? Possibly yes, in certain areas, but still people still do traditional stuff these days as well, right? Like, because again, like I realized that when I started like using, for example, iPad, and I started seeing like painting on iPad or drawing on iPad, like they don't need any fancy tools, they just need like one cool app so they can just draw, do little scribbles and do something that really kind of, and a lot of times when you see people doing that, they are super slow, you know. It's not also about the speed or the layers or like all these like cool computer features that we have these days. I still see people and artists who just like use one brush and they're like super methodical and they're just slowly chipping away and creating these masterpieces, you know. Again, they're doing it because they love it. Can they be competitive? That's another question. You can obviously, if you're too slow, probably like as a commercial artist, you might not be competitive, but still, if you're doing a great job or if you have a great design sense, how long does it take? As long as it doesn't take like a year to create an artwork, it doesn't matter, you know? Yeah, and this is kind of like describes my personal sort of vision on this, you know? Obviously, with AI, there's a lot of like copyright issues right now that needs to be sorted out, because it, like, obviously feeding that huge library of images and asking no one about it is an issue. But there's a lot of cool applications to that. Unfortunately, I don't have it right now in front of me, but, you know, like in Photoshop, there's a plugin for Photoshop where you can like marquee or select like an area and type in what you want to, in that area. I would love to use like tool like this. For example, I remember working on this one and like, The feedback was like, oh, could you make like this background a little bit flatter, right? I would love just to marquee select this area and tell it like make like a flat desert in sunset instead of actually painting it. But again, would I do completely this image from scratch in AI? possibly in some cases, but again, I do remember like working on this one and first creating this sketch, which was like approved, and then I created this color version, and it's all like making those iterations and then finally moving into this kind of frame. That was like a fun journey, which obviously with help of AI, I could speed it up a little bit, maybe explore different versions. But there's something about this image that I feel very personal to myself. And this is why what I think when people say, oh, there's no soul, or there is a soul in the artwork, I think that's what they mean. And I recently, like, I was in Rome, and guys over there, they made like a small exhibition of my work. And the first time I saw my work like printed on a big canvas, and I loved it. It's not like it wasn't like just stroking my ego, which probably partially it was, but I loved it because I was like approaching the painting, and I was like looking at some of the paintings I've done for Mandalorian. And I would remember every brush stroke I did for those. Like, for example, over here, I remember like, oh, maybe I can use like this abstract brush to make it a little bit smudgy and a little bit less refined. And it was really cool. And it was also really cool when like people looking at my work, they were talking about, oh, look, this looks painted, this looks like photoreal and stuff like that. It was like super, super interesting. And I guess like, again, like I'm not saying this trend is going to continue. However, like with problem with AI art, when you start seeing a lot of it, you don't react anymore, you know, like because you get, it can spit out like, yes, I can generate this image in a day, but it belongs to my vision, right? But then you see AI art, which is like 20 pieces by just clicking refresh, it doesn't have what this does, at least for me, you know. I'm not saying general public, probably general public wouldn't care if you worked it on it or if you painted it or not. But for my own satisfaction, you know, when I'm alone, like in the evening, I have my nice music, I enjoy just painting and drawing and doing all this weird 3D stuff, right? That would probably no one can take that from me. For example, recently, I even stepped back and I started doing model kits. And again, you don't have my camera on, but I have like, I built a bunch of planes that I always wanted to build, like some of like military jets. And then I want to go back and do something with hands, you know, because I love that idea that like it kind of distracts me from my regular work as well. But again, don't get me wrong. All that I said doesn't mean AI is a complete dead end for artists. No, it has a lot of positive things, you know, exploration, giving you different ideas. There was this tweeted it. Hold on, let me just try to find it. There is actually like a stable diffusion add-on, or I don't know how they did it, but you do something in what do you call it, in Gravity Sketch, and it automatically like paints it up into whatever prompt that you gave it. I thought that was amazing. I'm not sure how it's a little bit laggy on your monitor, but you can see how it works basically. Like over here, you create something in Gravity Sketch, and over here, it automatically does sort of like realistic version of it. And again, these are very simple examples. I think this was very cool when you can actually quickly design something. And this is where like we can pose it here and talk a little bit about this step over here. You can see like a person in VR generates something, and then you're sort of seeing much more polished version of it by using AI. Again, this is still like artist designs it. You know, it's not like AI just takes this and spits out whatever it can generate. You still have this design driven by a person. And then obviously it takes and does what some artists don't have. Like for example, some designers, they can't paint or they can realistically render something. But they are fantastic designers. For them, AI is fantastic, and it will bring a lot of good things on board. Let's say, for example, you are a mech designer, right? But like from here to here, it takes a lot of time. Again, as an artist, I would enjoy doing it, but there will be like certain projects where I don't need to do this, you know? Like I just need to come up with ideas, and I would love AI to help me to refine it. And yeah, there were like a bunch of examples. And as you can see, like you change this prompt, I guess like if you, from a cute 3D robot, you would change a prompt like to an ugly big robot, it will do the same, but only different with a different style and all those things. So these are very cool. I think like design-wise, this is fantastic. again, I'm curious how they're gonna sort out the legal version of it. Because like as far from what I understand, like whatever you see here is being like generated from the images that you fed this AI model. And obviously I don't think they ever ask anyone about permissions. They just throw in everything, you know. Let's see how it plays out. I guess like the best solution would be if you can fit your own artwork. Like, for example, if we go back to my work, where is it? Yeah, like imagine if I'm working on the Star Wars thing and I can privately feed this to AI and tell them, hey, I'm working on this location so it can learn my style and then it can mimic certain things. Then let's say I need to do a different angle or different iteration. I would use this library, AI train on this library to generate something similar and use the same style. That will save me a lot of time, right? So again, like first I talked about my personal sort of preference and what I kind of enjoy, but also I can totally say that for professional work, for design work, it could be fantastic, you know? And on top of this, you also have like visual effects work where a lot of times people do really, really time-consuming work that no one really shouldn't be doing, right? Like, let's say you're raising characters in the background. Like, it would be interesting to see how actually AI sorts that out. Again, right now, like, even the tweet that I showed you, I never tried it myself because in order to set that up, you have to be a scientist, and I'm not, obviously. So I'm just chilling out. I'm waiting for someone to sort it out and see how that whole thing panned out. Cool. Apart from that, I just wanted to show you like a very quick personal like things that I'm doing in my spare time. And obviously, this is where we kind of can jump back into VR stuff again. I recently took a course from Simon Lee. Actually, it wasn't recently, maybe a few months ago. If you don't know Simon Lee, Simon is a fantastic like digital sculptor. And he uses traditional media. And like me seeing him, how he creates stuff, it was like, oh my God, this is so, well, first it was so cool. But also what was interesting that he just like, he was doing exactly what I love about VR. And obviously probably to show that we will need to be in VR, I will try to show that. But what was very cool about that process is that he would, like, because he was just using his hands, for example, I've got these guys, two guys fighting each other, right? Like, because you with your hands, you can so easily manipulate. Like, for example, you can select this palm or fingers or head, and you can rotate it a little bit, you know? This is something that takes forever when you're in 3D because you're looking at the flat screen. Again, it's doable, but it's just so much more intuitive when you are in 3D space. For example, let me show you. I have more stuff over here. Where is it? Yeah, it's just, like, the same scenes. Like, reposing this character is so much faster in VR, right? And again, like I'm showing you this like very simple sort of mannequins because I think this is the best way to sort of to start and to establish something when you like using with less amount of details so you can concentrate on the gesture and all that stuff. And I did all this VR stuff in VR and I was showing Simon and he was impressed as well because like the way you manipulate objects in VR is just so incredible. And like I was generating a bunch of different things, you know, like, yeah, there's like this gorilla fighting this guy. Yeah, this is like obviously was generated in Gravity Sketch and then I just remeshed it so it becomes one mesh. But the whole energy of it, you know, like the way you micromanage things, like you move the biceps, you move the head, and you kind of tilt and twist this guy, that leg, and so on. It's so much easier to do in VR. And but again, like this was a point where I kind of gave up on Oculus Quest. So I actually stopped using it, but I still believe that this is like a fantastic way to sort of start my work, especially with characters. It doesn't matter even like with anything I'm working on. It's so cool that you can like quickly micromanage and do those micro changes to come up with different ideas. Let me show you more. I'm not sure why this is not working, but yeah, this one's interesting. Yeah, it's like this guy's an engineer and he fixes this robot, obviously inspired heavily by Star Wars. And then this guy gets old and the robot carries him. yeah, again, it's like when you're in VR, like moving things is so much faster, you know, like, and like the sparks over here with a couple of brush strokes, you can make it like look very nice and stuff like that. But that's again what I love about VR, you know, like when you can, like, for example, this head over here, if it was in 3D, like you have to rotate your camera, rotate it a little bit, rotate your camera. That stuff is so, like, pisses me off, you know? And again, we're going into this territory, you know, like I want, when I'm working on, like, whatever I'm working on, I want to have fun, you know? And if I find my approach very frustrating, which a lot of times when I'm just, I know, like, I can, if this was a real model, I was seeing this, like, done by Simon, you know, when he can just rotate stuff very quickly and just adjust, make those micro adjustments. And when I do this in 3D, it takes me forever. So that's why, like, usually when, if I would have to explore stuff in VR, like, I would do it in Gravity Sketch, because I can do, like, every single part would be separate, so I can move it as I want. And again, from here, obviously, the question is, how do you take it to the next level? It depends, you know, like, I can show you couple more. Yeah, like, for example, here I have a bit more or less polished stuff, so it's this little story of this lily hunter, and he's got this little cute frog over here. Yeah, and I do, like, all this stuff. I took a course and I was having so much fun, you know, and this is something that I would do in my spare time. There was one more, hold on, where is it? Oh yeah, so I have this one. Again, this is sort of Frazetta inspired piece where this ugly guy fighting this. And again, like, most of the time when I start, oh, you can see over here, this is the Gravity Sketch mannequin, and you can see it because of the shapes I'm using. Once I'm happy with this, because most of the time this is the most difficult part I find to set up, you know, with the proper gesture. And again, the least amount of details I have, the better, because then I don't need to think about, oh, I have very light models as well, and all I need to concentrate is just on the gesture, right? And then obviously I take it to 3D Code, which is a sculpting software. Let me try to show you. That's not the one. So let's go to another one. Yeah, so this is how the model looks like. And you can see, like, slowly I started refining it and, like, adding, like, all those layers of, like, clothing and stuff like that, but still it maintains the same energy that it used to have in that mannequin sort of VR sculpt, isn't it? So from here, this is just a matter of time, and just like making model kits, you know, this is still not finished. I need to find time to finish it, but it could take me another 10 days to work it up. But that whole process is what I love, you know, like, and whenever it's not, there's no, like, clock ticking in terms of client demanding to do something, I would just spend my time and refine and do that kind of stuff. But I'm going to show you another one. Obviously, I told you there was a point when I stopped using VR. So I was like, oh man, I love this approach so much, right? Like, if you, a year ago, I had such a struggle because I would have a headset next to me and I didn't enjoy using it. Like, I enjoyed the process, but physically, as I said, it was hurting me. I was like, man, I got to learn how to sculpt without VR, you know? This is where I picked up 3D Code. I loved 3D Code before, but 3D Code was a little bit laggy, and also it had some, like, weird issues, but they fixed it, and I was like, man, this feels amazing. So what I started doing, I, like, forced myself, like, genuinely, I remember times when my left hand would lean over to grab a headset, and I'll just, like, hit my own head and say, no, I'm not doing this, you know? Because I just wanted to kind of overcome that desire always to do stuff just in VR, because I wasn't sure about if in the long term it's going to be a good thing for my health. And it took a while. Oh my God, I struggled so much. And, like, I have a daily folder, which every day I would sculpt something, I would do something, and then I'll just come back to it. I will do something and I will come back to it. And this is where I am right now. Like, what I started doing, I would do this really quick daily characters. And I think all of this I did in one day, because I just found a way. It's not, I didn't find a way. I just, like, came to the level where I can just forget about the sort of complexity, the details and all stuff, and just focus on, like, sort of character work. And as you can see, like, the key to that would be just using one layer. Like, some of these characters, you can see it's just one guy, and there's nothing, no layers. Again, I would, at some point I will start separating them. But for example, if you look at the soldier, you can see like everything here is just sculpted as one piece, you know? And this goes back to the simplicity that I had in Gravity Sketch. Remember when I said like I love when everything is simple so I can concentrate on the bigger picture? Same here, like a lot of times what I realized artists when they sculpt, they just quickly jump into details, you know, because this stuff takes so much time to come up with. But from a distance, and this is again like the same way I use it as a designer, as an artist, when I start, I always start with broad strokes. And I always have trouble like in 3D to come up something that looks decent, but doesn't take a lot of time. And I think like I'm at the point when I actually found a good way to do this. And again, given time, like if I would have a more time, I would probably keep refining it and making it more perfect. Like you can see this one is a little bit more refined, and I'm obviously working on this guy. I'm going to show you a bunch of renders here just so you can see. Hold on, let me just drag it over to my other screen. Yeah, this is just one of the characters. Yeah, and that's the Roman soldier I was showing it to you before. And as you can see, when you slap on the textures and stuff like that, it actually doesn't look bad. And I spent like an hour and a half probably on this guy, which is like really, really super fast in terms of idea generation. And this is the whole lineup. Oh, obviously, what I also I'm trying to do when I'm working on this, I'm trying to set up myself like different tasks, because you know, like there is this famous question when specifically when you show 3D artwork, people go like, oh, what brush do you use? And a lot of times you hear it doesn't matter. Sorry, which is true. It really doesn't matter. However, it does matter because certain brushes, they do certain things better. And same in 3D, you know, when you're doing something like hard surface, you possibly would have a different approach to that when you're doing something a little bit like clothing, or you're doing armor and stuff like that. Every time you do that, you kind of, I need to find a tool that will do it in the best possible way. And also, I like it because coming from a 2D background, I always focused on the thing where it's not about like super fine details. I'm as a designer, I'm never get hired for that, you know. And personally, I don't enjoy doing that. Like I can spend a week on a character, but I don't, whatever I do is not, it doesn't need to be a film quality. And for example, if you look at this character over here, like you can see how I did the chainmail. There is basically like, there is a little bit of like chainmail sort of stencil, but the rest is just, I just drew it like, because like in voxels, like you can select like a round brush and then you can just do this, you know, you see. It's a matter of like finding this way. You do it a lot in painting, you know, when so like if you look at John Sargent paintings, like, or any kind of like Zorn paintings, Rollo paintings, you can see like a lot of details they do, it looks detailed, but when you zoom in, it's all like brush strokes. It's almost like abstract. So I was like, specifically with voxel like sculpting, where you can generate geometry out of nowhere, like by just painting it, like, or drawing it, like I showed over here. Like you can do all this kind of stuff. And look over here, it actually looks like, it does look like chainmail, because like usually when you just make it perfect, like let's say you use fiber mesh or whatever, like a nano mesh, it just looks too straight, and then you have to distort it a little bit. But that's what I was trying to learn basically doing this. And like if I open, like let me just open my daily folder. You can see I do so all sorts of stuff. Like I'm, a lot of times I just fail as like, oh no, this is not working. But then what I realized, like if I keep being persistent, and I'm doing that not because I'm stubborn, partially yes I am, but also I love it. I just like, no one forces me to do this. And eventually, like after some time, I realized, damn, this is actually working, you know. Like for example, this is something I was working like in the hard surface thing, and it's not bad, it's not perfect, but for like idea exploration, I felt it was like really, really cool. I was actually doing a car. I failed really hard on this car. Let me show you. I found some really cool things about it, but still I need to work a little bit more on this car. Obviously, this is, I did it purely in 3D code, but I guess like the best approach would be probably making it in Gravity Sketch. And then, but then again, this is all sculpted. This is like what I find really frustrating with low poly modeling or like sub-div modeling is that you have to be very careful, right? In sculpting, you don't have to, but the problem with sculpting, it gets very blobby like this, right? But as you can see, I didn't finish it yet, but I felt like over here, it's not bad. And this is like a really shiny sort of thing, material. If you put something a little bit more matte, I guess it would be even more forgiving. But I'm still working on it. Let's see how it goes. But what I like about doing this in voxels or like in sculpting is that you can make quick changes, you know? Like, for example, you can grab the whole thing and do something like this, you know? That's something that is quite difficult with sub-div modeling, isn't it? Like, if you're doing this, let's say, I doesn't matter what program you use, but it's still something that it's quite challenging to do. Again, it's pros and cons. I'm still exploring, but I actually like it. Maybe I should refine it at some point. Yeah. And then I was like, maybe I do something like from Star Wars, you know? And that was a whole different challenge because it had so many planes. And I was thinking, like, how can I make that happen? And obviously for that one, I was using different tools. But yeah, you can see my journey, like, and I'm not done yet. It's so much fun to be working on this. For example, I've been doing like this head studies when I would like open a bunch of like duplicates and I'll just like make different like characters, you know, and it's really, really cool. Still exploring that. Yeah, I've got tons of this. As you can see, if I scroll down, there's so much, like that's a lot of stuff going on. Yeah, but I guess that we are running out of time, isn't it? So this is sort of my journey. I'm still exploring. I'm still learning every day. And the good news about artists, art versus AI, there is no like one or the other one, you know? Like I still value myself as an artist. So I do certain things because I like, and it doesn't matter if it's marketable or if someone is going to pay for me, to me. Obviously I need to be smart in terms of like, I can't just let it go and do my personal stuff because then I'm not getting paid. So, but then again, I don't think AI or any sort of technological advance will take away the joy of creating stuff, right? So I think this is where we save. Obviously, I welcome AI in terms of like, it's a great design tool. They need to sort out this legal issue with the kind of feeding images without permission to their libraries. But let's see how it goes. Just like with the VR helmets, you know, Daniela knows. I said, like, I'm not using it forever already. But then I changed my mind with the new headset. So I'm always trying to be open-minded because what I believe in, like, there's a lot of people, really smart people, work on products. And if they're doing something cool, that needs to be taken in consideration. And if they fixed, like, with 3D code, there was a point that 3D code was awful. You know, everything they were doing was wrong. And I stopped using it, even though I was, like, using it 10 years ago. But then they fixed it, so I jumped back on. So, and it's just getting better. Same with VR helmets. Hopefully, one day they will be super light. And then, because it, just like I mentioned, the approach itself is fantastic. Well, we didn't have any time for VR, but I don't have a camera, so I would show you this new Quest and show how it works, but it doesn't matter. Cool. Danielle, that would be it for me.
Yeah, awesome, Jama. Thank you so much for this. Yeah, it was interesting to hear your perspective around VR, but yeah, I really appreciate that you can like give us your insights on like the whole experience. Now, for the Q&A session, we have a lot of questions from the audience, but we've also invited Jordan Taylor, co-founder and CEO of Viscom, an AI tool. So it would be kind of like an interesting conversation. Probably Jordan has a few questions for you, Jama.
Yeah, nice to meet you, Jordan. Yes, let's do it.
Hey, how's it going, Jama?
Good, good.
Yeah, that was a great presentation. I love your work. I've been a fan even since when I was a student at CCS. I remember seeing some of your stuff. So I guess my question is, you know, how do you feel? And I've talked to Scott about this many times. You know, how does AI play its role, you think, in this future where authorship and creative control is going to probably become more and more important? And like, how do you see, you know, maybe students having to change their mindsets about this, or the space just fundamentally kind of shifting its perception of what even authorship is? I mean, like, how do you see these things playing out from like an artist perspective? I have like my own like technology company guy perspective, yeah. But like, I'm yeah. curious what do you think about
yeah,
this?
Yeah, I sort of already laid out like the way I think about it, but to sum it up, I generally don't know a lot of things right now because it's evolving so rapidly. But for yeah. example, I was back home with my nephew and she's trying to get into illustration and she was like, she does this anime stuff and she loves it. And obviously she started studying and I recommended a few fundamental sort of courses to her and she was studying. But then as we were having a conversation, I would have like Midjourney on my phone and I'll just like type in anime, like doing this and that. And it would spit out amazing pictures, right? Mm-hmm. So again, I still recommend her and anyone who wants to get into art learning fundamentals, because like a lot of times I see this pattern in myself because I have strong fundamentals. Doesn't matter what I use, like it's VR or it's 3D, it's 2D. I still am able to yeah. operate with those because I have very solid fundamental sort of knowledge of composition exactly. of color and all that stuff. But then again, when sometimes you have people with vision, you know, and they don't have ability to draw or model, but they do have a design sense, mm-hmm. because drawing and painting and 3D modeling, it's sort of tool to create something that you have in your mind. So probably for them that would be super useful, you know, and or compensate some of the things you're not doing great. Like for example, I guess like I keep giving this example, but like if you use Photoshop a little bit, like you know, there's the content-aware fill, which is like people use to remove signatures. Usually, remove like a third person in your picture or something like that. Mm-hmm. It's when you lasso an area and you say like get rid of it, right? That was like this sort of like in essence what could AI potentially help us to do? Not like to remove things, but to amend things. Like let's say you have a composition of two guys, but you want like a spaceship in the background, right? You can just lasso that area and type in like Star Wars ship in the background, so just plugs in something like that.
Right.
But let's see how it goes. Again, will some people take advantage of it? I guess so, but that's yeah. always the case, isn't it? Like, but also what is interesting, like, again, I think like, I just briefly like witnessed that with Twitter, you know, when people said, hey, like if in the music industry you came up with something like Midjourney, people will come after you because like you can't just use samples from other like people's work, right? Like music samples. But with art, no one even hesitated, right? Because there's no community and no one even hesitated uploading like billions of images. So yeah, it's
interesting. That argument is always so interesting to me because it's like as humans, we get inspired by the work we see all the time. Yeah. And we might subconsciously, you know, make iterations of things we've seen before, but is that still the same? Is that considered like copying, like, you know, I mean, like, I don't know. It's such a I don't know.
I see you come. I see your point of view. I don't know. Mm-hmm. That's why, like, I'm still observing and seeing how it pans out. Like, I do use it for professional work sometimes if I need to come up with some weird, interesting ideas. Mm-hmm. However, just like I showed in my like sort of story, I just love doing this, you know, like, and the more technology advances, actually, I think I'm going backwards, you know, like, because I just love to step away from computer and do stuff like in real world. But I still enjoy the journey. Totally. So it's still all cool and valid. Just let's see how it pans out, you know?
Yep. Super exciting future.
Cool. Jordan, do you have any more questions before we jump into the questions from the audience?
Yeah, no, we can go straight.
Yeah, I mean, I thought it was going to be an interesting chat for the two of you to get together and talk about all of this.
Yeah, yeah.
So Jama, do you feel artists should push harder against AI companies using our work? Because I saw their approach to their early music AIs and they say they only train them on license-free music from the start. But with art, they didn't seem to care.
Yeah. You know, I knew this similar question will come to me at some point. And I sort of like thought about it. I think I'm the wrong guy to ask that question. I will explain. This is very traumatic, though, my answer is. like I come from ex-Soviet Union, like, and I lived in like in a country which is similar to ex-Soviet Union most of my life, and I never had like a feeling that I can change anything, you know what I mean? Like in those countries, like for example, countries like Russia right now as well, like regular people can't change anything, right? And I've been in the UK for so many years, but I still feel I have this legacy. Like I think that I can't change anything, you know? It's like imprinted in my brain, and that's bad. I know I need to get rid of it. To answer this, I think we should fight against it. Am I doing this now? And I don't think it's the right thing. Because I've witnessed when people for so many years battled against the system and they ended up not being good, you know. So I think this is my personal sort of post-traumatic experience that affects my decision making right now. But I think we should, in a way, if it's so bland and it's so obvious that they're doing this. And again, when you're seeing like signatures being smudged over, I don't like it. And I appreciate when people stand up and say something about it. But personally, I never did that, and I explained why. But I don't think it's also the right thing. Like, we should be doing something about it. I'm coming from a system where people for decades they would fight the system and they failed. So hopefully that kind of explains this my mindset right now. You know.
Yeah, and there's actually artists have gotten together and created this website called haveibeentrained.com, and it's a place where you can either enter your name or upload your artwork, and you can see if your art is actually in the data set of what's called Fusion, which is the Lion data set. It's this massive it's like a 5 billion image data set that's 170 terabytes of all the images and text on the internet. And you can basically put your name or upload your artwork on this website, and you can see which part of your artwork is actually in that data set. It's pretty wild. So they're already starting to, you can see people already kind of, not necessarily pushing back, but providing insights in ways to then create new conversations around the subject matter of like, oh, okay, well, now that I know which art pieces of mine are in here, or what kind of like, you know, other stuff's in here, now I can like maybe, you know, reach out or et cetera. There's people doing this, So it's a really interesting, it's such a new, fun, you know, like 5 years ago, or even 3 years ago, this kind of conversation would almost make no sense.
Yeah, I know. Like, wait, I know.
Why are we talking about if my artwork got trained on this?
Cool. Yeah. All right. What courses or approach would you recommend for to the artist getting into 3D and VR?
Oh, wow. That's a difficult one. I haven't thought about that. What courses? I guess, like, really, if you have a solid sort of fundamental knowledge in 2D, you can just go on YouTube and start with basic fundamentals. You know, I'm pretty sure there's like good or well-organized courses as well, but to get like your head around interface and all this stuff, you can just go on YouTube, like get like most viewed tutorials there and start from there. Yeah. And if you're picking up 3D, the Blender is today's the way to dive into it. You know, it's free. There's a lot of resources on that, and it's pretty reliable, pretty cool as well.
What do you like about 3D code?
Oh, I love everything about 3D code. Yeah, well, Daniela knows better than any other person here, because I literally so many times brought it up. Make voxels in the gravity sketch, right? I love voxels, you know? Like, I love that you can actually carve into a model or, like, take a brush and just draw in 3D space. It's very similar to my approach in 2D. You know, when I draw, I do the same. That's why I never liked ZBrush. And again, I'm not shying away from saying that. It doesn't make me feel good when I'm using ZBrush. Like, I feel struggling so much and I feel frustrated so much. Is it a great program? Absolutely. Is it for me? No. That's why I love 3D code. So, and there's nothing wrong about it. So if you're using a software and you love it, there's no, like, at some point, like, maybe like if you met me 5 years ago, I was like, oh, this is a great tool. Everyone should try it. But these days, I'm now like people like use tools that they feel comfortable with and that make them happy, you know. That's why, like, it's worth trying, but it's not like it's gonna change your life, you know. A lot of stuff that I showed takes so much time and practice, so it doesn't happen overnight. But the overall kind of approach with voxels is very appealing, and that's why I love really good. Yeah.
Nice. We keep having a lot of questions in the audience, but we're running out of time. So I'll just ask this last one because it might be interesting for everyone to hear. Do you use Adobe Medium for voxel modeling?
I tried Adobe Medium. Yes. When I got the new headset, which was like a month or three weeks ago, I tried it. It's really cool because it has also the desktop version where you can just take the helmet off and continue doing it. I like it. And again, was the question Adobe Medium? I used Adobe Medium, but now I tried Adobe Modeler, which is a new thing. And I thought that was a great improvement because they changed a lot of things and it was really, really fun to use as well.
I never heard of voxels being a preferred mesh representation. Like, I've never heard of voxel modeling. I don't know why this is the first time hearing this. Well, it's like super blocky.
No, it's not only super blocky, it's with voxels. Like, let's say if you're using traditional, like, oh, I would say normal surface mode, you can just stretch the surface, and when you stretch too much, you see polygons. You have to remesh it. In voxels, you don't have to do it. And on top of that, voxels, you can create them. It's basically like a 2D brush, but in 3D space. So what you think in terms of voxels, plus Minecraft voxels, obviously.
Yeah, I'm thinking of like Minecraft.
That's a different thing. Yeah, that's great.